Things are rarely ever new in Formula One, and the new cycle has once again stopped a flexi-wing contretemps as the current teams have formed factions over their use. Video footage of Red Bull's rear wing tilting back at high speeds on the Barcelona straight at the Spanish Grand Prix courted the ire of Mercedes, with Lewis Hamilton quick to draw attention to the bendy wing on the RB16B. And thus, the can of worms was opened. Ferrari and Alfa Romeo have since also admitted to introducing air elasticity into their rear wings, and it seems distinctly possible that there are more teams who indulge in the flexi-wing practice. The situation is now that the FIA wants to introduce more rigorous testing at the French Grand Prix, to ensure that wings do not flex under load, even though the current wings already pass muster and scrutineering. As ever in F1, this decision suits nobody. Mercedes and McLaren want the revised flex tests before the Azerbaijan Grand Prix at Baku, but the likes of Red Bull, Ferrari, Alfa Romeo, and anyone else in possession of a flexible wing argue that this will cost them more money to stiffen up their designs. On TV, Red Bull team boss Christian Horner, who's been through a few scuffles on flexing wings during his tenure in charge of the squad, drew attention to Mercedes' front wing, which also appeared to flex downwards towards the ground, and suggested that the Silver Arrow's qualms were rooted in hypocrisy. As the throwaway bendy rear wing comment from Hamilton was uttered, it pulled upon a thread that has unravelled a significant subplot to the 2021 season. Oh, what fun. But what is a flexi-wing, and why do Formula One teams want them? Well, first of all, flexi-wings are, well, wings that flex. Strictly speaking, all wings flex, as it's impossible to achieve infinite stiffness, but some do so more than others. In Formula One terms, this is usually manifested in a tilting action. At speed, the front and rear wings produce more drag as the velocity of the car increases. In mathematical terms, the square of the velocity determines the drag force, as per the following equation. Drag force equals coefficient of drag times frontal area times air density times velocity squared, all over 2. As speed increases, therefore, the force pulling back the car increases exponentially. As such, you can't use all of the maximum drive of the powertrain to produce speed on the straights. At circuits like Monza, teams use skinny wings to slash drag, but at the more conventional circuits, you need the full size of the front and rear wings to generate downforce in the corners. By tilting them back at speed, this can reduce the overall frontal area of the wing, and perhaps its drag coefficient entirely. By using that formula, the increasing square of velocity is being marginally offset by the reduced area and drag coefficient. The truth is that all the teams would dearly love to have infinitely flexing wings on their Formula One cars, as the front and rear wings would theoretically straighten out and colossally reduce drag on the fastest sections of the circuit, but under grounds of safety, they simply cannot do so. The FIA does have tests to ensure that wings don't flex during scrutineering, with front wings being subjected to load tests and rear wings being subjected to pullback tests too, which are described in the technical regulations under Article 3.9. But why are flexi wings discouraged under safety grounds? The study of aerodynamics in Formula One is often considered as aerospace, but turn it upside down. Because many of the same principles exist between the two fields, they share many of the same problems. Aeroplane wings flex very slightly because the structure must be a trade-off between rigidity and weight. Materials with a high torsional strength are often heavy, and the same is true of an F1 car. F1 wings today are produced from carbon fibre, and often use a low-density core, such as a foam, to provide further rigidity, so they're still light and rigid. But the same is true that the more weight you add, for example using further plies of carbon fibre, the more rigid it becomes, therefore the trade-off still exists. But if a wing is too light, then it will likely lose strength. Under load, this means the wing could break, be it through contact with another car, or through effects developed by aeroelasticity. And aeroelasticity itself is its own scientific field, and although elasticity is desirable for some applications, it can leave a wing or a structure exposed to phenomena such as flutter. If an F1 wing flutters, this means it produces a very unpredictable level of downforce, which can fluctuate between extreme values. As such, if a driver is piloting a car with that level of unpredictability, there will be undoubtedly instances where they have a very low level of downforce in braking for a corner. Now naturally, that can result in a very nasty crash if they can't get the car stopped in time. And flutter is a harmonic motion, and if exposed to frequencies by oncoming airflow that approach its natural frequencies, that could also tear the wing apart in very extreme cases. So by increasing rigidity, that can be avoided. Those reasons are why the FIA conducts scrutineering to assess the structural integrity of the car to ensure the drivers remain safe within the cockpit. So what will happen next? As more stringent tests fall into place for the French Grand Prix, this should reduce the wing flex used by teams even further. There will undoubtedly, as Alfa Romeo and other teams have said, be a cost to this, which will upset the teams operating close to the cost cap, but it can be argued that safety is priceless. Now that won't stop teams from trying to flex their wings to the maximum level allowed, but it will cut the amount of performance derived from using a flexible wing geometry. In the future, as material science continues to evolve, F1 could well allow wings to change shape more flagrantly over the course of the race. But under the current rules,
this that's happening here is not allowed.